What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the 2021 Virtual March Madness Tournament here on College Sports Revived. Last time out, we tackled the first round of Gonzaga and Michigan's region, so today let's hop into Baylor's South region and Illinois' Midwest region as we wrap up the round of 64 today. And as you guys know, I had to create a majority of the teams in the tournament for this mini-series, and even though it was fun to do, it was definitely a grind, but now I have all 64 teams completed, so these episodes will be coming a lot more frequently as we try to catch up with the real NCAA tournament. I had to put a lot of time into creating pretty much more than half of the field, but now it's all done, and it was a very rewarding feeling having all 64 NCAA teams completed, especially after I had to do a decent amount of them. So the 1 seed versus 16 seed of this South region, the Baylor Bears, take it to the Hartford Hawks. Naturally, very high expectations for the Baylor Bears in this tournament and in the real life one. They made the Final Four, obviously, just a couple games ago in real life. Maceo Teague with 28. Mark Vidal had also a solid game in this one, and Mark Vidal was the guy on Baylor a couple games ago in the Creighton game, actually, where he came down very awkwardly out of bounds. It looked like there were some serious damages on there. Thankfully, he's okay, and the Baylor Bears look as unbeatable as ever. Now we look to the 8-9 matchup. Who will be playing the Baylor Bears? The 8-seeded Tar Heels of North Carolina or the 9-seeded Wisconsin Badgers? And this is a game I got right in the real tournament. I did have Wisconsin beating UNC just because Wisconsin, we all know how deep the Big Ten was this year. But Wisconsin still has the most matured starting five in the entire Big Ten Conference. They start five starters. And take a look at the virtual game. Wisconsin comes down here late in the fourth quarter and takes the lead, outscoring UNC 23-11 in the final few minutes. So let's hop in to our first game action of this second part of this series. And going inside is Garrison Brooks, putting a little drop step move on Micah Parter. No good, but he does clean up his own mess, and the Tar Heels have another chance to take the lead with only seconds left to play. Leaky Black will go to the rim. He's one of the best penetrators probably in the entire field, and Black gives the Tar Heels a one-point advantage with the Badgers and crafty point guard Demetric Chice taking it up the other way. Brad Davison, open off the screen, will not give it up as Chice, and he'll take this one all the way to the rack. A tough finish there, a lot of contact, but the body control serves him well. Wisconsin back out in front with 20 seconds left to play. Leaky Black with a 6-second difference between shot clock and game clock will receive a screen here from Garrison Brooks, but he slips, he's open, but Black will wait till he posts up to give it to him. Brooks inside. He's taking a while to try to get a shot off, and he's whistled for an offensive 3-second violation. Oh no, the Tar Heels might have just choked this game away. Oh man, Roy Williams down the stretch, what is his bunch doing? They will send Demetric Chice to the line with 5.5 seconds left to play. The first one he rips clean. So UNC still with a timeout in the ball game, make or miss, they still have a chance to either win or send it into overtime depending on the result of this free throw attempt, and Trice's attempt will rim out. So 2-tie, 3-win, 5 seconds flat to go for the UNC Tar Heels for a chance to take on the top-seeded Baylor Bears of their region. The inbound goes to Davis, their point guard. 2 seconds left, pulls up in the face of Trice for the win! And it just cannot fall. Oh man, Wisconsin will barely survive the Tar Heels. Some bad plays on both sides here down the stretch. Roy Williams, just like in real life, he just retired. No shade to his Tar Heels here. I know Garrison Brooks might have choked that game away, but no shade to his Tar Heels, done a great job, but just like in the real life game, the Tar Heels come up short, and then for the first time, Roy Williams loses in the first round. He has a first round record of 30-1 in his entire career. Thank you, Roy Williams, did a great job at UNC, have a good retirement. 5-12 matchup, a very popular upset pick, Villanova versus the Winthrop Eagles, and I went a little ambitious on this one. I got this one wrong. I had Winthrop winning just because they go 12 men deep. I mean, they're such a deep team in real life, but and also Villanova, they were missing Colin Gillespie and Demir Cosby Roundtree, one of their best bench players, and just like in real life, Winthrop is knocking on the door with 1.5 minutes left to play. And instantaneously off the inbound, they're going to go to their best player, Chandler Vaudrin. He's their best player on paper. A beautiful Euro step around Jeremiah Robinson Earl, who has the potential to be a very solid NBA player, I might add. So Winthrop out in front with 1:22 left to go. Colin Gillespie is active for the virtual tournament. I did not have injuries on here in the 2K version of this tournament. Gillespie no good, but he does recover, and the Wildcats have another chance to take the lead. 6 seconds left to shoot. Ball reversal to Gillespie. He's open. Swish for Gillespie. The seasoned veteran puts the Villanova Wildcats on top, and you can see in the real-life tournament, they really missed his presence whenever they played Baylor in real life. 43 seconds left to go after a stop by the Wildcats as Gillespie pulls again just outside of the free throw line extended. And Gillespie single-handedly playing a huge role here in the virtual tournament. Winthrop, a lot of shaking of the heads there. Their demeanor is a little bit down. Their backs are against the wall here. Vaudrin again will try to take things into his own hands. Crossover on Gillespie will take this to the cup, absorb the contact, and put it through. Chandler Vaudrin again delivers, and with a free throw, he can bring the Winthrop Eagles back within one. So Vaudrin toes the free throw line for a huge attempt, and the rim not very friendly to him there. The ball bounces out, but Winthrop's still down just a single possession, so they're going to try to hope for some misses here from Gillespie at the line. Gillespie is a 6'3 senior. He shoots 83% on the season, but the first one, a lot of missed free throws were seen here today, that's for sure. So the door's still wide open for Winthrop. Make or miss from Gillespie. The second one also cannot find the bottom of the net. Winthrop still has one timeout left. Vaudrin and his Eagle teammates deciding not to take it as Vaudrin trying to body up on his defender, but he will think better of it and try to dribble out this clock a little bit. So what does Winthrop have in store? Trying to upset the 5-seeded Wildcats. 11 seconds to go in the game. Vaudrin looks like he wants to go to work. Hesitation move on the Wildcats defender, and he explodes to the rim. Dunks it down with two hands. And we're knotted back up at 65 apiece. The missed free throws leaving the door open for Winthrop and this game-tying slam by Chandler Vaudrin. Unsung heroes on both sides, Gillespie for the Wildcats and Vaudrin, of course, for Winthrop. Let's head to overtime. Villanova, however, with a huge run to kick us off in the extra period of play and a very valiant effort by the 12-seeded Winthrop Eagles, but all in all, just not enough left in the tank. 86-77, the Wildcats, they do survive the upset bid, just like in real life. And Gillespie, you can see him, 26-12, they missed him. And Demir Cosby Roundtree in the real tournament. Charles Faldon actually led the way for Winthrop, but it was Vaudrin's second half that gave him the opportunity to make some noise there at the end. So, moving on. The winner of this game will take on Villanova Wildcats, the 4th-seeded Purdue Boilermakers, and the 13th-seeded North Texas Mean Green. In the 2K Sim Engine, trying to make it 4-for-4 here in the virtual March Madness tournament. They got the first three picks right. Let's see if they have North Texas shocking Purdue, just like in real life. North Texas is actually a team that's pretty near and dear to me and my good buddy Aiden. We actually have a dynasty on NCAA Football 14, where we've taken the reins of North Texas and built a pretty good program. Me and him have had a lot of fun moments on that. So it was nice to see them have a chance in the tournament to dance, but it's not going so well for them here in the virtual tournament. Down 15 with 2 minutes to go, but out of nowhere, they cut it to 1 with 13 seconds left. Wow, and as we look at the game log, they were down 85-68 with 2 and some change left to go, but a 20-4 run to close out this game, and the Mean Green have a chance to shock the Boilermakers just like in real life. Wow, if North Texas can get this thing done, that would be amazing. Purdue, however, they do have a chance to save themselves. Eric Hunter Jr. steps to the line for a pair of free throws. North Texas does have a timeout left, so make or miss, they still have a chance, much like the Winthrop game. And the first one, oh man, more missed free throws the further and further we go along in the virtual March Madness tournament. Eric Hunter Jr. with one more chance though to at least put them up 2. The second one will hit the bottom of the net. So 10.7 left. The Mean Green burn their last timeout. A sideline inbound for North Texas. They got 11 seconds left in their control. James Reese will be at the controls as he takes this one on. Sasha Stevanovic, and he wins the matchup at the rim. 3-point play opportunity for James Reese to knock this thing up with a chance for one more at the line to take the lead with 5 seconds left. Not only did he fight off Stevanovic's defense, but Purdue has 7'4" Zach Edey. He also tried to come over from the weak side to block that shot, and somehow, some way, James Reese put enough touch under it to get it over the 7'4" big guy for the Boilermakers. Now, a lot of missed free throws here we've seen in this episode. What can Reese do? Will he step up and hit it? It's good. North Texas in the lead. No timeouts for the Boilermakers. Stevanovic will rush things up the other way. 3-2-1 for the win. Stevanovic is short. North Texas completes the comeback of epic proportions, one that we may not ever see again here in the virtual March Madness tournament, one that will go down in the history books for sure. 91-90, and the virtual March Madness tournament, it improves to 4-for-4 today. Every matchup has been predicted correctly so far. Javion Hamlet had 35, but it was James Reese's three-point play that will go down in North Texas history as one of the most important plays in program history. I personally have never seen anything quite like that in 2K Sim Engine, a comeback of revolutionary proportions. I don't even know how to explain it. They were down by 17 with 2.5 minutes to go, and they climb the mountaintop to face Villanova in the next round. So moving on to the next matchup, we have the 6-seeded Texas Tech Red Raiders against the 11-seed Utah State Aggies. I went a little ambitious. I had Utah State winning this. Nemias Queta, one of the best players not only in the Mountain West Conference but in the entire field. He's a beast in the interior. I just was a big fan of him coming into this game. But Texas Tech, just like in real life, they controlled the tempo for most of this game, but it's getting pretty intense down the stretch. Utah State storming back 29-22. They had the advantage in the third quarter, and with 2.5 minutes, now 2 minutes to go, we'll hop in with the Aggies up by 2, and immediately off the inbound, Nemias Queta, after I just talked him up a pretty good amount, he immediately turns over the ball, a lazy pass. So the Red Raiders, they decide not to take the advantage with the numbers they had. They'll slow it down with less than 2 minutes to play. Kyler Edwards, the other man who joins Mac McClung in the backcourt for the Red Raiders, gets it done. What a floater that was. Enough touch to get that over the outstretched arms of the Aggies defense, and Edwards has 13 points on the game. But surprisingly, no Mac McClung out on the floor, as immediately coming back the other direction, Edwards goes from hero to zero as he allows a three-point play. Knocking down the free throw would be the Utah State player. 76-75, we are approaching 60 seconds to play. They feed the post into Quita, who puts his shoulder into the teeth of the Red Raider defense. Another basket goes for the Aggies, and now the Texas Tech Red Raiders starting to sweat a little bit, down by 3, the most crucial possession of the ball game for Texas Tech thus far. Kyler Edwards will receive a screen, go between the legs, and that looked like a pretty good charge attempt, but Quita is whistled for the foul, his fourth, and that could be monumental down the stretch, only one away from his disqualifying foul. 45 seconds left to play, still down by 3. Edwards, another screen here. He'll navigate to the left side. He'll stroke it, but well short on the three-ball attempt. Not the best look down the stretch. And all in all, the Red Raiders would fall. So, the first game that the Sim Engine gets wrong, as Nemias Queta, not even top 3 scoring for the Utah State Aggies today. They were helped out with 26, 22, and 16 from 3 other starters. Quita did chip in 4 blocks, and Mac McClung, who we didn't really see much there in the last 2 minutes, he still led the way with 16 for the Texas Tech Red Raiders. So, Utah State versus the winner of the 14-seeded Colgate Raiders and the 3-seeded Arkansas Razorbacks, who recently just participated in the Elite 8 in the Real Life Tournament. It was pretty funny when I saw this matchup in the Selection Sunday show. Right when I saw Arkansas and Colgate playing each other, I thought to myself, man, this game's going to be 102-98 or something like that. I figured at least one of the teams is going to break into double figures just because of how these teams play. They're so similar in their attack. You see both these teams in the real-life tournament, they got into each other's skin, pressing full court, all 94 feet. And they all play, both these squads play a very up-tempo style. And we kind of saw that here in the virtual tournament. Arkansas takes this one 101-86 as JD Note, who had a really good game the other night against the Baylor Bears. He had 26 points. Justin Smith a little quiet. He's actually their second leading scorer on the team in real life. Still, didn't hurt them in the final box score, as Richardson for Colgate had 26 as their top performer. Two more games left to go here in Baylor's region. We got the 7-seeded Florida Gators against the 10-seed Virginia Tech Hokies. This was a really fun one to watch in real life. VTech, their comeback at the end, that big three hit by Jalen Cohn that forced the game in overtime, but unfortunately, at least in my bracket, Florida did reign victorious in the overtime period. And just like in the real game, Florida had a big lead, but now we see VTech not only tying it back up, but adding some conviction, pouring it on here at the end. And it was a double-digit win for the VTech Hokies here in the virtual March Madness tournament, 85-68. So VTech will play the winner of Ohio State versus Oral Roberts here in the virtual March Madness tournament. Trey Mann, he had 24, the Florida Gators, and on the other side of things, leading the way was a monster effort from one of Virginia Tech's big guys, the man who leads them in not only points but in rebounds as well. He had 34 and 15, Kiveh Aluma. What a performance from him tonight. And as we move on, of course, my Buckeyes going up against Oral Roberts. Yeah, this one was definitely one I won't be forgetting too, you know, anytime soon in real life. But hopefully Ohio State in the virtual tournament, they can right their wrongs. Honestly, Ohio State's loss didn't affect me too much in my bracket because even though I'm a Buckeye fan, I also consider myself a realist. I didn't have them going very far in the real life tournament. I actually had them losing to VTech in the round of 32 just because Ohio State, they're a very skilled team on offense, got some athletes, but they just were not a very cerebral team in real life. They didn't have a high IQ on either side of the floor, really, and you saw that in the Oral Roberts game. And of course, ORU with the leading scorer in the entire country, Max Abmas, he had a great game against us. I already knew we were in for a show whenever he came out off the tip and started hitting 35 footers on us. But Ohio State, they do get the revenge this time around. Dwayne Washington, much better game here in the virtual tournament. A double digit win for the Buckeyes. They move on to play the Florida Gators. Hopefully they can make some noise in the virtual tournament. And just because ORU got smoked here in the virtual tournament does not mean that Max Abmas did not leave his mark. He still had 32, 4 assists, 2 steals, and 2 blocks apiece. Just wasn't enough to overcome the Ohio State's team attack. So, Ohio State versus Florida to round out the South region. Let's move to the Midwest as the number one seeded Illinois Fighting Illini with their big three of Kofi Coburn, Ayo Dosunmu, and the three-point specialist Adam Miller with very high aspirations. They will take on the Drexel Dragons, the 16 seed. And in this game, of course, in real life, not much issue for the Illinois Fighting Illini. And that reigned true in the virtual tournament as well. You saw there, actually, Drexel was only down by 4 at the half, but imposing their will is the Fighting Illini of Illinois. They take this one 81-57 with nobody really able to match up with Kofi Coburn, the 7-footer, 295-pound big guy from the Bahamas. He had 25-12. Ayo Dosunmu was on triple-double watch, but the Drexel big guy, James Butler, with 25-13. Not too bad, kind of holding his own there with Kofi Coburn. Now, America's underdog. We got Loyola Chicago, the Ramblers, with Cameron Crutwig, a guy that everybody seems to have fallen in love with the way he manhandled Illinois in the real life tournament, going up against the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets. NG Tech, they do have the ACC Player of the Year in this one, Moses Wright. He was actually inactive for the real life game against Loyola, but they will have his services in the virtual game. But it didn't seem to be too much of a added advantage for the Yellow Jackets. Loyola takes this game pretty convincingly. G Tech made it a little bit more competitive there in the third quarter, but overall, Loyola stomps the Yellow Jackets. Lucas Williamson with 34-10, and Cameron Crutwig, a guy with a very high IQ. He's a senior. He was on the Loyola Final Four team back in 2017. He had 29 today, and Clemens also pitched in for 19. Michael DeVoe also had 19, leading the Yellow Jackets. Moses Wright with 18, 4-4. Jose Alvarado, the pass-first point for G-Tech, he had 12, 6-6. So the virtual March Madness there went a little bit cold, got some picks wrong to end out the last region, but it does nail Illinois and Loyola correctly. Let's see if we can make it 3-for-3. Will it take Oregon State over Tennessee just like we saw in the real life tournament? can't imagine that the computer will have Oregon State going as far as it did in the real life tournament, making their way all the way to the Elite Eight, and that reigns true here in the simulation. The Volunteers, they take it to the Beavers, 75-58 is your final. Ethan Thompson, who had a great real life tournament for the Beavers, he didn't do too well in this one. Santiago Vescovi, he had 14-8-9 for the Volunteers, along with Josiah Jordan James with a double-double. John Fulkerson also with a double-double. And Yves Pons, he chipped in 9-7. And as we turn to the Beaver side of things, Thompson had 21 points. He got his, but on 23 shots as well. And the big guy for Oregon State, a guy I like a lot, I can't even pronounce his name, but he had a good one, a double-double. Now, we look to see who will face the Tennessee Vols in the second round. Oklahoma State, with the likely number one overall pick in the draft next year, Kate Cunningham at an 85 overall, the top rated player in the field this year against the Liberty Flames. And thanks to the monster effort by Cade Cunningham, no surprises here, this one was not as close as the real life game. A 30 point win for the Cowboys, 104-74. Cade Cunningham, 43 points, 12 rebounds, 4 assists. And he was also helped out by the brothers, the Boone twins, 18-8 and 9-2-3 respectively. So let's move on to another matchup that I actually successfully picked it correctly. The 11th seed Syracuse Orange against the 6th seeded SD State Aztecs. And this was a game I did get right. You never want to bet against Syracuse and Boeheim whenever they're a double-digit seed. They always seem to make noise due to their 2-3 zone and their length. I mean, think about it. Why do you play a zone? Why do you play a zone? Because you can't match up, right? So it's pretty interesting just to see how much damage they do in the tournament whenever they're the lower seed. Here in the virtual tournament, they did give the Aztecs a run for their money, closing it to 2 at one point in the final 5 minutes to go. But San Diego State, with one of the best players in the entire field, Matt Mitchell, that seemed to do them just well as Syracuse came up 11 points shy. 96-85 is your final. Matt Mitchell, he was a tag team last year with Malachi Flynn, but Flynn graduated for the NBA draft. So Mitchell, the team is his now. He had the reins to do some damage. And Buddy Boeheim, who's been lighting the world on fire in the real tournament, 23 for him tonight. He really showed that he's not just some coach's kid. He can ball. He had 23 here in the virtual tournament. So San Diego State will take on the winner of the 3-seeded West Virginia Mountaineers and the 14-seeded Morehead State Eagles. It's cool to see a Ohio Valley team. I'm excited to see if they can make some noise, potentially being the highest ranked team to win here in the virtual March Madness tournament. They do have a freshman sensation, Johnny Broom, at 76 overall. He should be in for a test as he has to try to limit the damage by Derek Culver, the first team all Big 12 selection big guy on West Virginia. But as we near the end of this ball game, 58-58 is your score with 2:02 left to go. So the Morehead State Eagles from the Ohio Valley Conference, the same conference that UT Martin is in another series of mine. Let's see if one of our opponents can make some noise here in postseason play. 2 minutes left to go, and immediately, no hesitation, they're going to feed it into Johnny Broom, the freshman who's been leading Morehead State in real life in points and rebounds. He's got 20 here in the virtual game. 60-58 as the Mountaineers call timeout, and you can see they're sweating as they head into the huddle. Down by a single basket, Miles McBride at the controls, a fan favorite player here on West Virginia. Here we receive a screen from Culver, a deadly pick and roll combination, McBride and Culver, and Miles McBride will soar up for a two-handed jam to tie things back up at 60. Under 2 minutes to play, going back inside to Broom. He will power his way, but that one is knocked away from him. So a lot more resistance there from West Virginia. It'll be a sideline inbound for the Morehead State Eagles. As Potter scans, he'll give it to the point guard. And eventually, they will work this thing inside too. Once again, no surprises here. Johnny Broom receiving the pass, drop step move. That one will rim in. Over 20 points today is the freshman Broom, and he is making one of the best defensive teams in the Big 12 look silly today. 62-60, only seconds left to play. As McBride, he's open, doesn't want to take the three. He was open off the pop screen. Instead, with a second left to go on the clock, he'll force one up. No good, but Culver's there for the cleanup. And these West Virginia Mountaineers heading back to the huddle. Look how hyped they are, and they got a right to be. That second chance point by Derek Culver might have just saved their season. 46 seconds left to play, 62 apiece. As we see, Morehead State, they want to go inside again. A baby J for Broom. This time, he doesn't have the same magic. Almost knocked away. He stayed with it, tried to get a cheap steal there. But instead, West Virginia will force things up back the other way. And McBride, not so lucky here on the pull-up J. So, with the shot clock turned off, Morehead State will opt to use their final timeout of regulation. And this was a pretty interesting play drawn up by Morehead State. They're using Broom as almost a decoy here. Instead, they'll let Devin Cooper, their point guard, isolate. And that one is swatted. Miles McBride doing it on both ends here down the stretch. Sends that shot into the third row. What a clutch play there. But at the same time, it's just as good for Morehead State. They have a chance to set up an inbounds play with 17 seconds left, going inside to Devin Cooper again. And he'll pull this thing out. 12 seconds left to play. And what it was that defensive rotation by West Virginia. I guess they were trying to think a little bit outside of the box there, bringing a quick trap to Devin Cooper. But you can't do that and leave Johnny Broom, of all people, with nobody in his path at the rim. Sometimes the box is just a good place to be. So anyway, 10 seconds left, 64-62 after Bob Huggins burns his last timeout for his Mountaineers. We see McNeil. He tries to find Emmett Matthews for the win. He's open. This one will just rim out, and Morehead State will hold on for the upset. 64-62. And this is actually a beautifully run play here. Derek Culver, the wide body, sets a great screen for Matthews, and the Southpaw has a chance to win it. A beautiful pin down screen. You can't ask for a better look than that, but the rim not in West Virginia's favor down the stretch, and Morehead State, the highest seed to advance here in the virtual tournament. In real life, we've seen Oral Roberts make the Sweet 16. UCLA is about to play in the Final Four in a couple days, so anything can happen, and maybe Morehead State can be the Oral Roberts of the virtual tournament. Who knows? That's why this is going to be a lot of fun to do this series with you guys. Derek Culver led the way for the Mountaineers, and on the other end of things, we have Johnny Broom with 24-10. Wow. The freshman from the Ohio Valley Conference torched the West Virginia Mountaineers tonight. So, Morehead State will take on San Diego State in the next round. Meanwhile, the 7-10 matchup here in Illinois' Midwest region, we got the 7-seeded Clemson Tigers led by Amir Sims, the burly 6'8", polished though, 245-pound big guy who leads the Clemson Tigers in every major statistical category except for steals, and of course, the freshman sensation Ron Harper Jr. for Rutgers basketball, and Rutgers with a big lead heading into the final 5 minutes, but Clemson chipping away. Do we have a chance to be witnesses to another big comeback? And it looks like Clemson will have a chance. A couple empty possessions down the stretch. I wanted to hop in with a minute and a half left to go, but both teams seemingly could not find a bucket here down the stretch. So we're gonna actually hop in with 30 seconds left to go. Ron Harper, who's had a great game today, he will take this one baseline, and he is met with some resistance. He's having some trouble holding onto the ball and forces one up into traffic. Eric Tyson, great stand there down low. 80 apiece as Clemson's got one last chance to do it here in regulation. Amir Sims, he's pumped up. He's ready to hold off Rutgers here down the stretch. And now we see this is Nick Honor on the outside with 10 seconds left to operate. 6 seconds left to go. He'll find Amir Sims, who's had some positioning, but he opts to wait and forces one up in traffic. No good. Amir Sims had the chance to attempt the layup there. He had the positioning and the angle to put it in, but I guess psychologically, he just hesitated and resulted in a miss. Now with 1 second left to go, this inbound will go to Geo Baker for the win. That one! Oh, Geo Baker had the chance to knock down a shot of a lifetime. Rutgers with not the prettiest play drawn up there at the end of regulation, but as you saw there on the replay, that would have been good if it went down, but unfortunately, Baker just a little off target. Now we head to overtime, another OT game here. We've had a lot of great ones this episode, but Clemson, the convincing effort in the extra period, they will knock off Rutgers. Great comeback win for the Clemson Tigers. They respond, outscoring them 14-6 in overtime. Amir Sims, 27-17. He responded after that blunder at the end of regulation. Al Amir Dawes also had 20. Nick Honor was 17-7. Overall, great team win for the Clemson Tigers. Ron Harper Jr. with 22-5 with that missed layup. He also had 7 turnovers. And Geo Baker, near triple-double for him. And even with Miles Johnson's nasty double-double, 10 and 23 rebounds, it just wasn't enough for the Scarlet Knights. Now for the final game of this episode, we got Houston taking on 15 seed Cleveland State. Unfortunately, I couldn't find Cleveland State's jerseys on the 2K share feature, so I replaced them with the Bryant Bulldogs just because I found their jerseys and in the roster that this guy created. He did have Bryant's full roster, so I figured, you know, they're about on the same tier as Cleveland State. And it resulted in a pretty realistic win. 89-79, Bryant / Cleveland State. They made it a little bit closer on the final score just because they had some garbage time baskets as Quentin Grimes with 26-6. Dejon Giroux had 13-9. He's been playing a little dinged up in the real life tournament, but still playing well as Houston did make the Final Four just a couple of days ago. So taking a look at the bracket, we come to an end here in the second episode of the Virtual March Madness Tournament. And all the games in red are the games that we got done today. And very surprisingly, a lot of games were actually predicted correctly. You saw there in the South region, Baylor, Wisconsin, Nova, North Texas all were picked correctly. And then the computer went on a little bit of a code spell as it mispredicted the next 3 out of 4. But I guess that's just the type of stuff we're going to see. What's in store for us coming next episode? You see there all the games in red, the games that we got done today. In the next episode, we're going to be taking down the entire round of 32, beginning back in the West. Then we're going to hop to the East, the South, then the Midwest. The entire round of 32 coming to you guys next episode. Stay tuned for the next installment of the Virtual March Madness Tournament here on College Sports Revived. Thanks for watching.